Hello students, welcome to Wisdom Academy. I am Nasreen. Today we will be seeing GPP unit, that is General Principles and Isolation of Elements, second part, that is isolation of metal from concentrated ores. Last class we have seen how to concentrate ore using four methods: hydraulic washing, magnetic separation, froth flotation, then leaching. Now after that we have a second step of isolation of metal from the ore which has been concentrated. So here we have two steps. First one, we have to convert this concentrated ore to oxide. So whatever may be, maybe it's carbonate, sulfide, whatever may be it, the form should be in metallic oxide. So we have two methods here. First one is calcination, the second one is roasting. So calcination is heating in less or absence of air, that is what calcination. So here we take carbonate ore, so we heat it, carbon dioxide will be evolved out, we have only zinc oxide, which is metallic oxide. Second one is roasting. In roasting, heating in excess of air, like we have sulfur, sulfur cannot be separated as it is, so we have to convert to sulfur oxide and we are separating and heating in presence of oxygen. We have here also we have zinc oxide. Both cases we get zinc oxide, but when we have carbonate we are heating in absence of air or less air, but when it's sulfide we are heating in presence of air. So this is calcination and roasting. So conversion of concentrated ore to metallic oxide. The next one is conversion of this oxide to metal. So here what we will do is we will use a reducing agent in most of the cases. Like if we had iron oxide, we are using carbon as a reducing agent. So we will remove as carbon monoxide and iron will be there. So metallic oxide will be converted to metal. So this is the second step here. In some cases, like even if you take iron, you need to supply high amount of energy, high amount of heat energy to enhance reduction. So whenever you apply high amount of heat energy, that process is called pyrometallurgy for reduction. So in reduction, sometimes it takes place in normal temperature also, but in some cases you need to supply more amount of heat energy, that process is called pyrometallurgy. So this is regarding reduction. Now we have seen calcination, roasting and followed by reduction, but in some cases we do oxidation also. Oxidation in the case of non-metals. For metals we do reduction, but if suppose we do need to extract a non-metal like chloride ion that to produce chlorine, so there we have to go for oxidation. So generally we produce chlorine from brine, that is from sea water, suppose we take, and we take any chloride, sodium chloride, potassium chloride, any strong chloride, and we treat it with water and we electrolyze it, undergoes electrolysis, it produces chlorine gas, hydrogen gas and any base. If we take sodium chloride, it is sodium hydroxide, potassium chloride, potassium. So the complementary base will be formed there. Now this chlorine, that is Cl minus to Cl2, this has undergone oxidation reaction. So in 11th standard you have already seen minus 1 to 0 is when the number decreases, so it is negative number decreases, so it is oxidation. So here chloride ion has been oxidized to form chlorine. This chlorine will be liberated in anode. So we have anode, cathode and electrolyte. Hydrogen will be in cathode, chlorine will be in anode, and OH minus will be in the electrolyte, that is in the solution of the cell. So this is an example for oxidation reaction. So reduction is for metals, oxidation is for non-metals. So the third step is refining or purification of metals. So first we will start how to concentrate a ore, then the second one is how will you prepare metal from the concentrated ore. Now the metal which is prepared will not be 100% pure, because we have done many chemical reactions with that, so we will have any chemicals or reagents or some impurities also. So the last step is very much important, that is refining or purification of metals. So here we have six steps, so we will see one by one. First one is distillation. We all know what is distillation. First we need to evaporate, then we need to condense. So based on different boiling point we can separate the mixtures. So here when we take a distillate, that is we have a metal with some impurities, and when we do condensation after heating, when you do condensation, metal will be there in the distillate, all the impurities will be evaporated and then condensed. So in this case we have only metals, so using distillation we can separate metals and impurities. And here example is zinc and mercury can be purified using distillation. The second one is liquation. Liquation is same as like how we saw in hydraulic washing. The substance is placed on a slope, but the slope will be under heating with high temperature. So when you place it, all the metal with low melting point will be moving down, but the impurities will be staying on the surface. So tin having low melting point will be moving down the slope, while the impurities will be remaining on the surface. So liquation can be used for low melting point metal. Then the third one is electrolytic refining. This one we have already seen. We have cathode, we have anode, then we have electrolytic solution. So basically it is electrolytic cell. We have anode, we have cathode. Anode is an impure metal, cathode is a pure metal. Then we have, this is anode, this is electrolytic solution. If you take copper, this is impure copper, this is pure copper. Then this copper solution, like say copper sulfate. So this anode, from anode reaction is, we take anode reaction. So copper will be going to solution as copper 2 plus plus 2 electrons. So this is the reaction. The copper present in anode will be coming to the solution. In cathode, the copper present here will be going, copper ion will be going to the cathode. So Cu2 plus plus 2 electron gives you C, the reverse of anodic reaction. So anode, the copper present in anode will be coming to the electrolyte. In cathode, electrolyte, copper present in the electrolyte will be moving to the cathode. So this is anode cathode reactions. So now if there is any impurities, it will settle down near the, below the anode, which is called anode mud. So anode mud is nothing but impurities which will be attracted by the anode and will settle exactly below the anode, which is called anode mud. So this is electrolytic refining. So here we use copper zinc refining. So next one is we have is zone refining. Zone refining is somewhat new for us. Actually, the phenomenon of zone refining is impurities will be moving towards molten state. They won't be staying in the solid state. It will be moving to the molten state. That is, if we heat, the molten state will be preferred by the impurities compared to the solid one. Like if we have a, this is the metal which has some impurities. Okay. So now we are placing it in a chamber and we are making two heating rolls. So when this heating rolls move through this chamber, this part will be heated now. So when they move, this molten state, when they heat it, it will convert to solid state to molten state. This molten state will also move from this direction to this direction. So along with the molten state, impurities also move. But the metal will be there in the same position, but the impurities with the molten state move along with the with this side. So as when the heat rollers are moved to the side, molten state will also move. So after one time, or we repeat many times, all the impurities will be moved to one end. So after that, we need to cut that end and remove the molten state, because molten state only will have impurities. Other part, other solid state will be free of impurities. So this is called zone refining. Zone means separating molten state from the solid state. So we need to heat it, and the roller should be moved only in one direction, so that from one side it is moved to the other end. So that at the end we can just cut it and remove the molten state which has impurities. So this is called zone refining. And zone refining is particularly for semiconducting materials like germanium, silicon, gallium, and even boron also. So this is for zone refining. So next one is vapor phase refining. In vapor phase refining, you need two conditions. First one is metal with any reagent will form a volatile compound. So first one is formation of volatile compound. The second one is the volatile compound should easily decompose. Volatile compound formation is okay, but if volatile compound does not decompose, we cannot get back our metal. So there are two conditions. First one is it should form volatile compound. Second one, the volatile compound should get easily decomposable. So here we have two process. One is Mohn process, another one is Van Alker method. So in Mohn process, we purify nickel. So nickel is treated with carbon monoxide. It forms nickel tetracarbonyl. So nickel tetracarbonyl again heated and decomposes to give nickel, and carbon monoxide will be evolved out. So here we get pure nickel. Heating in very high temperature, other impurities won't exist. We have only nickel here. The same with Van Arkel also. But here we, instead of carbon monoxide, we use iodine. So this is particularly for zirconium and titanium. So Van Arkel for zirconium and titanium. Zirconium is treated with iodine to give zirconium iodide. So this is volatile compound. So when we heat it, so decompose, we get only pure zirconium and iodine gas is liberated. So this is Mohn process and Van Arkel. So Mohn process is for nickel, Van Arkel is for zirconium and titanium. The last one is chromatography. So the chromatography also we have already seen in our 11th standard. So chromatography is based on the adsorption, like different element, different compounds are adsorbed in different levels. For example, we take column chromatography. In column chromatography, we have a column with the opening and a knob. Okay. So now this column is filled with a stationary phase. Stationary phase means it won't move. So stationary phase, example like silica, alumina, any stationary phase which is good adsorbent, which adsorb easily. Then we have a mixture. That mixture is mixed with a particular solvent and the solvent is poured from the top. That is called mobile phase. Because it is going to move from top to bottom, so that is called mobile phase. The component or mixture which we have, we need to dissolve in a solvent and that will be poured on the top so that after some time it will pass through the stationary phase. If we have like two components A, B, A will be absorbed on the initial stage but B will be absorbed in the final stage. So this is the difference in the adsorption. So after every adsorption, we need to remove this column by inverting the column and we have something like this. This is the stationary phase with different adsorption of A and different adsorption of B. Now here we just need to separate this part and do other purification. At least we have separated A from B. So we need to just wash it and filter, we get A separate and B separate. So this is for chromatographic method. So this is column chromatography. Sometimes we use even paper. We have very less amount, like not even like 1 gram. We go for chromatographic methods. Example, we have paper chromatography. Instead of column, we use paper because paper also adsorb solvent. Then we use like a small plate, which is called thin layer chromatography. So we have paper chromatography, we have thin layer chromatography. The phenomena is same. We have a stationary phase, we have a mobile phase. This mobile phase will move to all through the stationary phase. The stationary phase will adsorb in different region. So when you remove the column or remove the stationary phase out, we just need to remove this, separate this part by physical methods. I need to just wash it out. So that's it. So this is the chromatographic method. So in chromatographic method, when you have mixture in very less quantity, you need to go for chromatographic method because in all the other methods, you cannot use with the smaller quantity. So if its quantity is very, very less, we can prefer the chromatographic method. So this is the sixth step. So for six methods, first one is distillation, which can separate impurities from a metals using distillation process, that is evaporation and condensation. The second one is liquation, in which high melting impurities are separated from the low melting metal. The third one is electrolytic refining. This gives you the more purified metal. Copper, zinc, you have anode, you have cathode, you have electrolyte. Electrolytic reaction takes place and the pure metal will be deposited in the cathode. Next, in zone refining, impurities will be there in the molten state compared to the solid state. So they will prefer to move towards the molten state. Using that method continuously, we can remove the molten state with impurities. Then the fifth one is vapor phase. The metal should become a volatile compound. The volatile compound again should be decomposable easily. So we have Mohn process for nickel and Van Acker process for zirconium and titanium. The last one is chromatography. When we have mixed in very, very less quantity, use two phase, stationary phase and a mobile phase. So these are six methods used for purification. So in this session, we have seen how will you convert concentrated ore to metal oxide, then metal oxide to metal, and the metal which you obtained need to be purified because to avoid some other impurities possible. So then we have using any of the six methods, we can convert this impure metal to a pure metal form. So thank you. Like the video, subscribe to our channel, share with your friends.